I'm Dr. Shelly Mehta, and I'll be guiding you how to prepare for FPD. Now, prosthodontics is divided into three parts: your complete denture, RPD, and FPD. FPD covers most of the conceptual part of your prosthodontics, so let's get on with it. Now, when you start with any subject, you have certain doubts such as what is the weightage of the subject, which books to refer for the subject, how much time should be allocated to this subject and to each topic, how many times should this subject be revised, what is the ideal time to start the subject, what are the important points for NEET, MDS, and what are the type of questions. So if these questions are bothering you, I hope this video helps you. Now, looking at the weightage for FPD in NEET MDS exam, in the past few years, approximately 2 to 5 questions out of the total 240 questions are asked from this topic. This accounts approximately for 2% of your entire paper. Now we move on to which books should be referred for FPD. So there are two standard textbooks. One is your Schillingburg and second is Rosenstiel. If you are an intern or post-intern and during your BDS days you refer to any other book, that's totally fine. When it comes to your MDS exam, just refer those books. It's totally fine. The theory is almost same. Don't change any book at this point of time. If you are in third year or final year, these are the standard textbooks. Now moving on to the time that should be given to FPD. So for FPD, you can complete this entire topic within 1 week. And out in this 1 week, you can give 1 to 2 days for your theory reading. It's a small topic and it's a clinical subject. That's why it's advised that you don't take any time more than 1 week. The next is what should be the time allocated to each topic. So when you start with any topic, you can give around 2 to 3 hours of theory reading and 6 to 8 hours of MCQ practice. This everything is for your first reading. The next question is how many times this subject should be revised. So you can revise FPD part around 4 to 6 times in your entire course. How this goes is, suppose I start with FPD, I'll take 1 week to complete it. Now after that 1 week, for the next 2 weeks, I'll do some other subject. After those 2 weeks, I'll go for my second revision. Now my second revision should not take 1 week, it will take less time, let's say 5 days. So that will be my second revision. And consecutively, whenever you have your mock exam, your grand test, you keep revising FPD. So that's how you come to this number 4 to 6 times. The more you revise, the better it is for you. The next is, when is the ideal time to start this subject? So if you divide your preparation into 4 halves, the last quarter, that is towards the end of your preparation, you can start with FPD. That is ideally after completing 17 to 19 subjects. Now we'll talk about the important topics of FPD. First is diagnosis and treatment planning. So you need to know about diagnosis, then you need to know about your extraoral evaluation, intraoral evaluation, ridge evaluation, the abutment evaluation, then radiographic evaluation. Then we move on to the diagnostic cast. You need to know about that. Then you need to know about the treatment planning. You need to know the indication, contraindication of FPD, advantages, disadvantages of FPD. Your pontic design, trauma form occlusion. For mouth preparation, there are certain modifications that you have to do in case you want to give an FPD. Then you need to know about the types of FPD, modification of FPD, and the most important is to know about cantilever, the principle and the concept behind cantilever FPD. Next is component of FPD, your definition of all the components and the basic mechanism, or why that component is there. That's important to know. Next is retainer. So for retainer, definition is important. When it comes to retainer, your abutment definition is important. Then just what is an ideal abutment? What are the conditions in which you can give an FPD? Then you need to know which abutment is better, a single rooted or a multi rooted teeth is better, and all those other criteria. Then what are the modifications that you will do? Suppose you have a tilted abutment. So what are the modifications you will do? So you have something called a telescopic crown, or you have 3/4 crown. So all those things are modifications in case you have a tilted abutment. Next is about connector. So definition of connector, your rigid connector, non-rigid connector. When it comes to non-rigid connector, you need to know male component, female component, the lock and key mechanism, or a shoe and key mechanism. And here it's important to know which part of the abutment has the key. So is it the mesial side or the distal side? They can give you a diagram and they can ask you the key lies in the mesial or the distal side of the abutment. This question can be specifically asked for your cantilever abutments. Next is to know about your indication of non-rigid connectors in FPD. Next is partial venial crowns, the indication, contraindication, and the same for your porcelain jacket crown. So indication, contraindication, advantages, disadvantage, and methods of tooth preparation for all these are important. Next, we'll talk about the abutment. So first is Anti's law. So what is Anti's law? Where it is applied? The concept behind Anti's law. Anti's law for FPD and RPD. Both of them are important. Next is optimal crown root ratio. So what should be the optimal crown root ratio? What is the ideal crown root ratio? Then we move on to the root surface area. So you need to know which abutment is better and what can cause complication and how can you overcome those complications in case the abutment is weak. Next is pontic. So the types of pontic. So the classification would be based on whether it is mucosal contacting, non-mucosal contacting. If it's non-mucosal contacting, then you have sanitary, modified sanitary. So you need to know at what distance above the gingiva it is placed. The exact measurement you need to know. Then when it comes to your mucosal contacting, so your modified ridge lap and all the indication, contraindication, advantage and disadvantage of all the pontics is important to know. Plus you need to know which pontics are given in anterior region, which are given in posterior region. Along with that, you need to know the gingival contact of each pontic. So for example, you have modified ridge lap, so it has a T-shaped contact with the gingiva. So all that is important. Then the ideal requirements for a pontic. So it should have your buccolingual dimension should be ideal, then it should have a highly glazed surface so that you don't have any inflammation with the gingiva. So all those things are given in your textbook well, and you have to know all that. So this covers your pontic part and your abutment part. Now we move on to technical consideration. For technical consideration, it would be my advice to open to Rosenstiel and open to the chapter of principles of tooth preparation. They have divided it into three parts: mechanical consideration, your biological consideration, and aesthetic. And they have explained all the points beautifully, which are actually very important for your NEET MDS exam. The first point would be the force that act on abutment. So your horizontal forces can cause a much more damage than your vertical forces. What is the effect of horizontal forces on abutment? What are the effect of vertical forces on abutment? Then structural durability. So all your, if you have your functional cusp bevel, that's a structure, that's for structural durability. Then your axial reduction is for structural durability. What are the other factors that can increase your structural durability? Then we move on to retention. So what is retention? What are the factors that are important for retention? How will you increase retention in case of FPD? Then what is taper? So the ideal taper is taper is 6 degrees. So if the taper increases, what happens? If the taper decreases, what happens? This can be asked as a concept-based question. Next is the freedom of displacement. Next is reduction. So reduction, you can have, there are different measurements for reduction. So you need to know the exact millimeter which is reduced. So what is reduced for a full metal crown? What is reduced for PFM? And what is reduced for a full porcelain crown? Then the type of crown. This involves your full crown, then your 3/4 crown, your 7/8 crown, all the modifications that are there, that comes under your type of crown. So for all the different types of crown, you need to know the advantages, disadvantages, indication and contraindication. When it comes to 3/4 crown, apart from knowing the advantage, disadvantage, contraindication, indication, you also need to know the method of preparation. You need to know the at what positions the grooves are given in case there is a retentive pin that's required, so at what position you do that. And for what is the modification in case it's an aesthetic crown, what is the modification, it's a posterior crown, then what is the incisal offset, all those things are important. Then for retentive grooves, you need to know the dimension and the location. Then for porcelain crowns and laminates, so you need to know the advantages, disadvantages, indication, contraindication, method of preparation of a porcelain jacket crown. So what is in what mm you will reduce the labial surface, lingual surface, occlusal surface, functional cusp, non-functional cusp, all those things. When it comes to laminates, you need to know the reduction, how much the tooth should be reduced and what is the procedure that you that is followed for preparing a tooth for laminate. Then for your metal ceramic restoration, again, advantages, disadvantages, the amount of tooth preparation or reduction that you need. So how much tooth should be reduced from the labial surface, lingual surface, your occlusal surface, functional cusp, non-functional cusp, what should be the type of margin, that's important. Then the type of finish line and the indication. So here all the type of finish line, even your feather edge, knife edge, because it's used in case of pediatric crown, so that's important. Then what type of margin will you give for a PFM? So and what will be the margin given at the labial surface, lingual surface? So that's important. Then you have your full porcelain crown. So what type of margin you give there? Then you have your metal crown. What type of margin? What is the amount of reduction that's required? Then one important part would be to know about pyre abutment. So for pyre abutment, as I told, there can be an image-based question. They can give you a pyre abutment and they can ask you where can be the key place on the mesial surface or the distal surface. So you have to answer that. Next, we move on to the modifications of your FPD. So this is minimally invasive technique. So you have your lost salt technique, Maryland bridge, then you have Rockset bridge and your Virginia bridge. So for all these, you need to know the advantages, disadvantages, indication, contraindication. You need to know exactly what is your lost salt technique and about your Maryland bridge. These two are very important when it comes to your NEET exam. Now we'll talk about gingival retraction. So there are four methods. First one is your mechanical method. This involves your cord. So you need to know how you place the cord, what is the single cord technique, what is double cord technique, which cord is placed for the thicker one, thinner one, how do you remove the cord, how do you take an impression after placing the cord, when do you place a cord while tooth preparation, while impression taking, all those things. Then second is your chemical methods of gingival retraction. Here the concentration of all the chemical materials that are used, advantages, disadvantages, any reaction, allergic reaction that it can cause, that's important, along with the percentage of the chemical material that's used. Then the third part is your surgical removal, that's surgical gingival retraction. That's important to know. And the last one is your electrosurgical gingival retraction. Then you have failures of abutment. So what are the causes of failure of abutment? In case you have a failure, how will you correct it? Next, before cementation, you have something called as provisionalization. So provisional, how will you prepare a provisional crown? What are the methods and materials that can be used for placing a provisional crown? What is the purpose of provisional crown and what are the ideal requirements of a good provisional crown? Then after that comes is your impression technique, impression material that are specific for FPD in case there is any modification. What are the modifications in case of FPD? Next, when we come to cementation, so the thickness of routing cement, types of routing cement, which type of cement can be used under which crown, if it's an aesthetic crown, which cement is to be used, light cured or self cured, all those things. Then thickness of routing cement, along with that, you also need to know what are the, after cementing, what are the precautions you need to take, how do you cement a crown. Then after cementation, if you have occlusal disharmony, so how do you correct it? So then we move on to the occlusal consideration. So you need to know the variation between central clination and maximum intercuspation, that is your central occlusion. Then you need to know about your canine guided occlusion, Yuk function. Who gave these occlusion? What is the exact meaning of these occlusion? In which conditions you can give canine guided and in which condition you should give a good function? Next is to know about Bennett shift and Bennett movements. Here you also need to know the meaning of Bennett angle, what is the exact measurement of Bennett angle, and what is the formula for calculating a Bennett angle. Next, we move on to understanding what is working side, what is non-working side. After this, there's something called a selective grinding. So here you need to know what is Bull's law. When you have selective grinding or when you have high points, which is the cusp will you that will you that you will reduce, which is the cusp that will not reduce. So that everything depends on Bull's law. Next, you need to know is your Baron point. Next is the type of bone quality. So when it comes to your implants, so all the degrees of bone quality are very important to know. Next is obturator. This comes as your part of maxillofacial prosthesis. So need to know the type of obturator, in which condition, which type of obturator is given, and the classification of obturators. Next, we talk about the type of questions that are asked in your NEET MTS exam. So the first is a single best answer when you have four options and one of them is a correct answer. Here you can have a case-based question where they can ask you which type of fonting will you use in anterior aesthetic zone, which type of fonting will you use in a posterior non-aesthetic zone. Then in case you have a pyre abutment, so you will use your non, which type of non-rigid connector will you use, all those things. Next is a fact-based question or a memory-based question. Here you can have question on the different type of pontic, different type of connectors, then on which side will the pontic of the pontic will your key be. Then you can have questions on the different concentration, the materials used for your gingival retraction, all those things. Your impression materials, composition of impression material, technique used for impression material, technique used for your provisional crowns, all those things are your fact-based questions. Next is a concept-based question. For this, your principles of tooth preparation are very important. What factors can lead to increase in retention? How can in which cases the retention will be decreased? In which case the resistance of the tooth is compromised? what is structural durability, how much axial reduction should be there. All those things are concept based questions. Next is your numerical value. So here you can have direct question asking about if you have a full metal crown, how much amount of the tooth should be reduced from the label side, lingual side, what should be the measurement for occlusal bevel or occlusal bevel or your incisal offset, all those things that are numerical based value. Again, here you can have a question asking you the percentage of concentration used in case of your chemical gingival retraction. Next is an image based question. So here you can have image on let's say telescopic chrome or a tilted abutment, your 3/4 crowns or your retention grooves, all those things. So everything comes under your image based questions. Next is a true or false type of question where you have one statement, you have to state whether the statement is true or false. That's the pattern of your NEET MDS exams. So that's how you prepare for prosthodontics. It's a clinical subject that you have studied in your final year and you keep practicing in your internship. So it would be my advice to focus a little less on the theory and practice more MCQs. Make sure that when you are reading them or studying the MCQ, you actually read the explanation very well, understand the explanation. In case you are a little underconfident with the theory, with the numerical values, with the type of pontics, all those things, so only read that part. Don't spend too much time on theory because it's a clinical subject, and I'm sure that you will be able to do great in this subject. All the best, guys. If you have any further doubts, please mention it in the comment section and we will solve it. If you want to see more of these kind of videos, please do like, share and subscribe to our channel. Also hit the bell icon to get regular notification whenever we upload a new video. Don't forget to download the app. The link is in the description. Thank you.